Welcome back to the Traders Network. I'm Michael Yorba, your host. Thanks for joining us. We're also streaming to you live on YorbaMedia.com. My guest for the next two segments is Nick Santiago. The man has made himself a lot of fame and fortune here on this show, being right on the markets. Nick, thanks for joining with the show today.
Thanks. Great to be here. Great to be with you again, Michael. Thank you.
Oh, my pleasure. All right, now I've got Simon with me in the studio.
Hello,
again.
Nick.
And he's got – I'm going to let him read a couple of questions to you that come up, and then we're going to get into the GLD, FXI, FXE, and so on. Okay?
Yeah. This,
sure.
This actually is from one of our listeners, Nick. They're asking the Shanghai Index broke below its 2010 low, and the dollar broke above its double top. What does this mean for the anticipated Christmas rally?
Well – right now, we're probably looking at the Shanghai Index. What I posted to my subscribers was to watch a potential turning point. It's very, very weak right now, but a potential turning point just short term around September 18th. And if you remember last week when I was on the show with you and Michael, I had mentioned that date as well. So it's going to be a pivotal date if that level can hold. The Shanghai probably will put a low in. Basically, I think around the 18th, just a short-term low. Ultimately, I think the Shanghai is going to go lower throughout 2012. However, in the short term, it's technically due for a bounce, and I think that bounce has a real chance of occurring around early next week.
Okay. Well, that was from Nevada. There's one other question in there I wanted Simon to get to. It's and it's going to lead us into the gold market. Do you see it there?
Oh, I see it. Yeah. The setup is looking like it's we should now short the gold and silver. Also, any chance the buy of a lifetime in gold and silver arrives early, i.e. before the end of this month, December, instead of 2011, or rather instead of 2012, pardon me.
Right.
No, I don't think there's any chance of that. As much as I love gold, and I do own bullion, and I do own gold and silver bullion, Michael remembers back in early August, I said, you know, watch for gold to top out. It's going to probably go into a severe correction, and then we'll get a lifetime buying opportunity in 2012. But I don't foresee that happening right now. You're going to get, you know, at best case, we'll get a bounce in gold now shortly. But that's all it's going to be, is a bounce. And the same goes for the base metals such as copper.
Right, you've been trading copper a lot. So, did you want to talk more about the gold or move to copper?
No, we could stick with gold. Gold is fine.
Okay,
the two are synonymous at this moment.
All right. Well, where do you see it going, and what do you see happening when as it's getting there?
Well, I'm not exactly sure where gold is going to wind up ultimately. You know, I was looking at the charts, and I have been telling my subscribers we're not going to be bullish gold until 2012. So anytime somebody wants to trade, it should just be a quick trade for maybe a couple of days. At best right now, you know, you have a major support level on gold somewhere around the 1400 level. So, I mean, there's a real good chance that will get there, sometime early next year. I'm not sure we're going to see that this year because I'm anticipating a bounce in this market, early next week.
Okay, so coming off of this September low, is a target that you're thinking is going to hold for a short term, then short that rally?
Well, I think, we're oversold now. The gold market's oversold. So, I mean, we could be due for a short-term bounce, in here, somewhere around, I guess, 1550 or around 1500. So, but early next year, gold should probably go test the 1460 level. That would be around the 20 moving average on the monthly chart. So I'm expecting that level probably to get tested early next year. But personally, I want to see gold goes down as much as it can. I'd love to see it go down to 1200.
So you can buy some more of it.
That's when we're going to load up the boat on gold. And, eventually this is how it's going to play out, is the European Union will eventually print money. That's what's going to come down the road. And the Federal Reserve will or may not print, do a QE3, but I believe they're going to, and maybe they won't call it QE3. Maybe they'll call it QE2.5. Either way, there's going to be more money printed, and that's going to ultimately lead to another inflation rally like we had in 2009 in September of 2010.
I don't know how they can get away without printing this stuff.
There's no way around it.
No.
Due to all that we have out there with, you know, the accounting changes, mark to market, accounting changes, now it's mark to model. This is the only way out, is really to monetize the debt. That's essentially what's going to happen. And in my opinion, you know, as traders, you know, we can't worry about that stuff. We just got to trade what we see. And on the charts will tell us everything we need to know. Michael, you and I both use cycles very effectively, and the cycles will generally point you in the right direction, and that's what you want to do as a trader.
Well, since you bring that up, and I'm glad you did, let's get into the cycle work. What are your cycles looking like for the gold market going forward here?
Well, gold ultimately is very similar to copper. Those two cycles are probably about 60 to 90 days apart. But both of them, I was more bearish copper, you know, as you know.
Yep.
And copper's really, you know, did everything we thought it would do and then some. Now I'm still bearish copper, and I believe, you know, on any bounce it can be sold short, and you'll get a real good, you'll be able to short every bounce in copper. Gold is going to be just a slight bit different, but either way, you know, gold should pull back, you know, and give us a real good, what I think is going to be a lifetime buying opportunity, sometime in 2012. I just want to reserve the date for when we get there. But, you know, I've given everybody, as you know, on your show, a long, long warning that this would take place.
Okay, that's good. Simon wants to move on to FXI?
Yeah, I mean, gold's really important. It's a major topic. But, yeah, the FXI, I was reading news recently that China's growth slows for the decade low. That's the recent news. The FXI, obviously, is an index that we could take a quick look at and perhaps get your thoughts on that.
Yeah, funny you mention it, because on this show, I think it was about a month ago, Michael, I had forewarned what was going to happen with China as well. And I said, you know, watch for, you know, China's going to be the next catalyst to lead us lower, even if there is a European resolution. I think it's more important at this time, because that's been the growth engine of the world. Mm-hmm. So really, you know, it shouldn't be a surprise to anybody that's been listening to your show, or my listeners, my subscribers are not surprised at all to see China falling. But we're due for a short-term bounce. And the truth of the matter is China is going to have to print money too. They're going to, you know, go back and devalue their yuan, and that's going to be their way out. So we're going to get, in some point in 2012, we're going to get massive inflation across the board, very similar scenario to what happened in 2009 and then after QE2. But China's slow, and they got a real estate bubble, and there's major problems over there. It's 1.3 billion people in that country that I think it could even be more. But just think about it. That's a lot of mouths to feed. When you break it down, if they have any kind of economic slowdown, I mean, that is just really going to rattle that nation.
Okay, so let me get this straight. You are not in the deflationary camp.
Well, I am in the deflationary camp, until some point in 2012, and then I'm going to be in the inflationary camp.
Okay, well, yeah, let's... I wanted to bring that out because, I was like going, okay, well, we're going to get some. Because, all right, sometimes.
Well, point blank is when gold goes down and trades lower, that's deflationary.
Right.
That is signaling deflation across the board. When gold rallies, that's signaling inflation across the board. And you know, we've been dealing with deflationary pressure since 2007. And if you want to go back, we could even make a case for 2000. And the Fed, basically, essentially lowered Fed funds rate to 1%, and now Fed funds rate have been at 0% since December 2008. So, you know, we are facing heavy deflation. The only thing is that they're going to, one more time, give it the injection button and create inflation.
Right. Well, we've got some timing models here, too, and they're leaning towards the middle of 2012 for some kind of a huge shakeup. Can you look out and see, tell me if that is something that's... you have some cycle dates there too, is what I'm trying to find.
Yeah, I mean, the middle, that's when you really want to start really buckling down and looking. If we're down, the markets are down into that time period, that's when you should start to prepare for the inflationary kick in, or the inflationary rocket, what I'm going to call it, because it will be a rocket. They're going to throw out the baby with the bathwater and create inflation around that time. But I my dates are a little bit different than the middle of the year, but that's when you're going to want to start to look, and see how these markets are behaving at that point. But it's coming.
Okay. All right. Did you want to talk about the FXE?
Yeah, we could talk about the FXE. It actually broke down to new lows, but the dollar now is just so far extended. I think the dollar is probably due to pull back next week. FXE could get that bid. But this is another, you know, currency where the euro is another currency against the dollar, where, you know, if we get any kind of significant bounce, I'm not sure how high it can bounce, but, you know, 135 to 137, I wouldn't rule it out, but those are going to be great shorts again. You know, last time I shorted the FXE was at the 141 level, and I covered at 132, and then it actually broke lower. And we had talked about this level, Michael, I think about a month ago, saying 129, 120, 129 would probably be where it ultimately falls. I just didn't think it would happen this week, but it's down there. So, again, that's another currency that could probably be sold short. The euro could probably be sold short on any significant bounce throughout, you know, at least the first half, maybe the first three quarters of 2012.
Okay. Let's go to a break now. And on the other side of the break, let's talk about the interest rates, the TLT, USO, and also a wrap-up with your opinion on the European crisis, okay?
Sure, sounds great.
All right, everybody, been listening to Nick Santiago, President and CEO of InTheMoneyStocks.com. Don't go away. On the other side of this break, you're going to get some great, great trading information. Welcome back to the Traders Network. I'm Michael Yorba, your host. Thanks for joining us. We're also streaming to you live on YorbaMedia.com. My guest this segment is the incomparable Nick Santiago, and I say that because the guy's been on the show and done some remarkable things and made some really, really good, good calls. And Nick, you're going to get a lot of Christmas cards this year, aren't you?
I hope so.
All right. Well, we were just talking about, FXE. Did you want to wrap up any kind of resistance area before we move on to the TLT?
Well, if you could see a bounce coming in the FXE next week, you're going to have to really look right at that. Let me just give you the exact level. 133 area. There's going to be, you know, that's going to be a big, big resistance point to get through. And if it can do that, it ultimately could probably trade up to 135. And then, you know, max move, and I like to do these calculations for my subscribers, what I call max move, would be around the 137, maybe 137 and a quarter level. But at 137, this is probably a stone cold short.
Okay. Now, in order for the listening audience to really be able to take advantage of that, they need to be able to get into the trading room that you provide for people so that they can actually watch you pull the trigger, right?
That's right. That's right. Or they could just join our research center, and you'll get all of our setups. You log in, and we'll have videos there, our nightly analysis. We'll have all of our master levels on cycles as well as prices. And there's just a lot there, a big bang for the buck. And you come over and take a 7-day free trial and see what we're made out of.
Okay, web address?
The web address is inthemoneystocks.com. And you could call us at area code 212-380-1578.
Perfect. All right, now let's talk about interest rates. It's something on everybody's lips these days because of what's going on. TLT, what do you think?
Well, looking at the TLT, it had a tremendous move this week, but you're going to watch for short-term resistance right at 122.50 if it could get back up there. That would be that swing point pivot high going back to November 23rd. So there's going to be very, very good resistance right at that level. Originally, I was looking for a 113, as I mentioned on your show, a pullback to the 113. That did not happen this week with that pullback we got in the mark in the S&P. But watch that 122.50 level. There's very, very good resistance up there.
Are you looking to short it up there, or you just want to see what it does and then make a decision?
I would consider buying a TBT trade, which is just the opposite of the TLT, but it's a two-time inverse. So you could short it up there, I believe, with basically just giving yourself about a $2 stop or even a little bit less, $1.75 stop.
Okay.
So there's no problems with that. I just got to see how it lands there. But I'm already under, you know, watching this thing like a hawk when it gets there. Right set up, I think, you know, you'll get that pullback there. Hence, that will give us the last leg of this little Santa Claus rally.
Okay. Well, when that occurs, just like I look at the markets, I know that you do the same thing too. You've kind of got an idea of where it may go off of that resistance area.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Well, I mean, you could probably look for a quick pullback to the 119 area. and then ultimately down to 113.
Okay, so 113 still in the, still out there on the
still table. In the mix. That doesn't change. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Let's go on to the USO.
Okay. Looking at USO, which is basically you know, another form, another way of playing spot crude. We've gotten a real real good sell off in this just yesterday and today as the commodity sell-off began and is under pressure. But traders should really watch the $35 level. I think that's a real significant spot. Maybe we go down a little bit lower to 34.50, but this is a big, big area around 35 to 34.50 for a bounce.
All right. Now, this has really got a lot of people wondering what's going on, because do you think that we've got an overall change in trend on the crude, or is this a, this going to give us a great buying opportunity for something that's going to happen in 2012?
Well, I got to be honest, I ultimately think oil is going to trade lower in 2012. I think demand will slow, and you know, just as we're in the same camp with gold and silver and also copper, I think they're all going to go lower. The same goes for oil. Oil gets a little bit of a premium built in because of you know, the geopolitical events that surround the Middle East with Iran and so forth, like of those factors. But overall, you know, I think oil can trade lower. And, you know, I've said before, you know, $90 oil is really just a real nail in the coffin for the economy. Most, you know, economy can't really sustain more than 60 days of $90 plus oil. So you know, we're getting into that area, but you know, it'll be a bounce trade for the most part, just the same way gold will be as well, but not a long term hold at all.
Okay, all right. So do you think we're going to hover at the $90 area? Is my question?
Because I think we actually will go lower in spot crude. Yeah, you know, if you're looking at the CL, I think we ultimately can probably trade actually a lot lower than that. So I wouldn't be surprised to see you know, crude trade down to 85 and then ultimately back down to the October lows, which were, you know, $74. You know, in 2012, I think crude could even break that level.
Now, there's a couple of ways you can look at that. That would be bullish for the economy because of all of a sudden that spread for transportation costs and comes back into the plus side on the balance sheet for businesses, or it's that bad that is a demand deterioration that pushes that price completely down to these levels.
Well, it could be good for the consumer. Definitely could be good for the consumer to have weaker or lower energy prices. That's always a positive because oil is really just a tax on the people. But really, what it's going to, in my opinion, it's just going to signal, you know, the deflationary pressures that we're going to face in you know, at least the first half, maybe even longer of 2012, and you know, an economic slowdown.
Okay, so that's where I was going with that with you. So this is really the result of an economic slowdown, not necessarily just a deflationary pop.
It will be both. You know, I think that it is deflation. You know, we are facing deflationary pressures right now, deleveraging, but
it's because of a bigger project, bigger issue, is what I'm trying to say.
You know, the way I look at it is, whether it's beneficial for the public, if people are losing jobs, it doesn't really, you know, it doesn't help anybody. So
right.
The way I look at it is, from a trader's standpoint, we're going to face deflationary pressures in all the commodities going forward in 2012. And then we're going to get, you know, a great buying opportunity in them again when the central banks just inflate this thing like a hot air balloon.
Okay, I got it. No, as long as you've got an idea of where it's going to go, and you've really hit it out of the park here a lot of times, too many times to not take what you say very seriously, then you can trade this thing with profitable strategies.
Yeah, and you're going to get bounces in between, right? So, I mean, I'm not always a perma bear or anything like that. I mean, we've gone long and we've gone short. We just want to be on the right side of the trade. That's really all you want to do.
That's what I was trying to say. Okay, Simon wants to talk to you about the Euro crisis.
Euro stuff, yeah. Nick, everybody's kind of been talking in all press about anticipating what happened this past week. There was really nothing coming out of those meetings. What are your opinions? I mean, Lagarde's quoted as saying she's comparing this landslide economic impact globally and comparing it to pre-1930s, for example, prior to World War II. What are your thoughts in terms of how that's going to majorly impact the markets moving into the new year?
Well, I think that, you know, I did see that. I did see what Lagarde mentioned, and maybe right for the most part. But the way I look at it is they're eventually going to print money. The stage has been set already to print euros. Draghi is in place. He's a printer. He comes from Goldman. The stage is set. The pieces of the puzzle are already in place. So it's a matter of – it will come. It's just a matter of creating enough fear out there for it to happen, because to have that resolution pass, you think you need all of the Eurozone nations, I believe. So,
but isn't that a Band-Aid? You know, printing more currency is a temporary solution, is it not?
Yeah, but it for a central banker, it's what they know. It's what they do. Mm-hmm. Right. I mean, I don't know any other way that the central banks have really ever, you know, solved a solution. Yeah. Right. The central banks run everything. So, I mean, basically, you know, if you print capital, basically what you're going to do is buy yourself some time and hope that things pick up.
That's interesting.
Just what Greenspan did with the in 2002 by lowering the Fed funds rate to 1%. Created the greatest, you know, housing boom that the United States probably has ever seen. And we saw how that ended up.
But it doesn't change the underlying politics of what got these difficult countries into the mess, you know, the pig bombs and so forth. It doesn't solve that underlying problem, really, does it?
No, it definitely see this again. Doesn't. Definitely doesn't. But I don't think they're in the camp to solve problems. I think they're just in the camp to put, you know, it's like our medical field, right? We don't cure anything anymore. We just treat it. So that it's the same premise.
Well, that's an interesting perspective, an accurate one, I'm sure.
Are you trading the euro off of that, or in specific with this knowledge, or are we just sticking with the indexes?
Are you talking to me,
yeah.
Michael?
Yeah.
Well, I haven't done anything with the euro yet, but like I said, the first bounce we get, if we get to those levels, I'm going to look to short the euro.
All right, that sounds good. Nick, give everybody a way to reach you so they can get into these, get the research out of you, and two, watch you do some of these trades so they can get on the right side of the market with you.
Sure. Come over to InTheMoneyStocks.com, try out the Research Center product that we have. You'll get our videos each and every night. You'll get all of our hot shots, charts, and alerts that we send out each and every night. We give you levels, cycles, and a host of other things. Come over to our chat room. You get to speak to me live each and every day. You get to speak to my partner, and you can follow us and watch our trades live as they happen each and every day.
Thanks, Nick. Everybody, we'll talk to you again tomorrow. Thanks for participating in the show.
Nick.